Dar es Salaam, the largest city in East Africa and the business capital of Tanzania. The house of one of the main African ports that handles 90% of the Tanzanian commerce. But it's not just about that. The place of peace is also the cradle of a new culture, which is asking for more and more attention.
My name is Hasheem Thabeet. I'm from Dar es Salaam, Tanzania. I was born in a city called Dodoma. My second, third grade moved to Dar es Salaam, and since then been living in Dar es Salaam. This is where I'm from.
Nowadays, Hasheem constitutes the living proof that it's possible to make it out of the neighborhood and to become a star. But what people need to remember is that nothing came easy for him. Everything started in Dar, where Hasheem lived a significantly humble childhood with his family and where he also studied school.
So I went to school here till like 11th, 8th grade. Around that time I left, and then I went to study in Nairobi, and then went from Nairobi to the States. It was a cool childhood, you know, being from here, from Tanzania. Back then, you know, we didn't have much, you know. We come from a middle class family. My dad worked for the government.
The height was also a dominating factor during his young age. Dealing with such body is not very common in Africa, and what comes with it can sometimes represent a complication.
With my height, you know, being, you know, a tall kid in Africa, it was, you know, it was a disadvantage, but, you know, I grew up with very strong family, and, you know, they made me believe, you know, I was just, you know, just another kid on the street. So, you know, I didn't really have a hard time with it, though, you know, I used to get in trouble and fight here and there just because of the jokes here and there, but, you know, as I grew up, I learned to embrace my height, you know, so it's kind of, yeah, it worked for me.
It wasn't love at first sight between Hasheem and basketball. As the majority of Tanzanian kids, he had different interests, but also a strong mentor.
Very interesting, like you say, yeah. Tanzania is a soccer dominated sport, but I grew up, my dad was a soccer player. So everything he did, I wanted to be like him. Like growing up, to me, he wasn't the Michael Jordan, the Kobe as my role models. Like, nah, my dad was my role model. Like, yeah, I went to school for architecture just like him. So my whole life growing up, he was in soccer. Till like, well, you know, as I got older, and then he passed away around that time, then I was like, you know, maybe, you know, I should try something different.
Everything changed after his death. In that moment, Hasheem realized that he should have started doing something on his own, for himself. That something began with basketball, but in the first place, he did not know he would have written a page of Tanzanian sport history through it.
Well, long story short, I got into basketball because of my friends. Yeah, I was like 16, literally, I should say 16. Growing up, you know, here we don't have a lot of basketball courts. There's a University of Dar es Salaam where we play basketball. A lot of people from outside the streets go there, and, you know, since they have facilities, you build facilities, people go come. Especially the, you know, in a third world country where we don't have a lot of facilities, we don't have a lot of equipment, so when people see the sports equipment, they want to use it. So we'll go play soccer at those grounds. But there's a basketball court, so we walk over it all the time. We go play soccer. One day the coach stabbed me, like, "Oh, why are you not playing basketball?" And I'm like, you know, I give him excuses, but, you know, and also here in the culture, when you are a young age, there's a certain ground you can't go and play with the older guys because they already have their own structure, you know. So, you know, I gave him excuses, but really I was scared to go over there and play. I gave him excuses, you know, I didn't have shoes here. Really, at that time, to find shoes my size here in Tanzania, it was hard. Anyway, so he got me jersey, got me shoes. One day I'm walking there, like we usually cross the basketball court, go play soccer. One day he stops me, tell me, you know, here's the shoes and jersey for you. From now on, you're gonna start playing basketball. So, he gave me the ball, he told me, run and throw the ball in there. I literally ran and threw the ball in there. Got the ball, told me to dunk, I dunked, and all my friends went crazy, and then I was like, oh, this is where I should be. Since then, you know, I just elevated it. So, you know, growing up, I grew up in soccer. My dad, you know, played, coached and played, you know, so I was always wanted to play soccer, but it got to the point where, you know, I just, you know, wanted to do something on my own. And then he actually supported, you know. They told me, you know, if you're going to do sports, make sure you do it very well. And then, you know, fast, and then, you know, the rest, you know, what I did was history.
At 16, Hasheem touched the basketball for the first time. But the path to glory was not easy. To play sport in Tanzania is not easy.
I wish I had found out about the sports at a young age. But, you know, I mean, to be honest, you know, growing up here is very hard for the kids. You know, like, we don't have basketball camps. Like, till I have to come back, maybe I do a camp here and there. You know, I used to do it consistently, but, you know, they don't keep stats. Like, I go back to work and come back and ask, you know, where the kids from last year's camp? And then, like, oh, we don't know. Oh, their parents told them to stop. Oh, now there's no sports in schools. So if you don't have those platforms to build that blueprint for the kids to actually, you know, build up that competition, you know, kind of desire in their lifestyle, you know, they're gonna grow up and, you know, that's why sports is where it is right now here in Tanzania. Because, you know, they don't follow it. So it's not like they don't know, it's just like it's not has been within culture.
As many other Tanzanian kids, neither for soccer nor basketball Hasheem ever considered the possibility of building a future in sport.
You know, here in Tanzania they believe also most of the people, yeah, they cannot make it through sports. You gotta be a lawyer, you gotta be a doctor, you gotta actually go to school to create life for yourself. They have no idea that you can, like, it's not they have no idea. It wasn't in our culture before. Till I start breaking those barriers, now you see these players playing, you know, soccer in Europe, you know.
Going to the US helped Hasheem widening his mind and understanding what his own country was missing.
After I leave here, I go to States where I see people doing training, like kids. I remember I'm in my 12th grade. We get invited to speak at a middle school, you know, like to talk to the kids about how important it is, you know, exercising and passing classes. They all come together, sports. Their focus is just education. You're gonna get education. But, like, okay, education, but there's also, you can get scholarship. You can become a doctor with this scholarship through sports. You know, there's a lot of kids in the States that goes to college for free just because they play sports. But, you know, here they don't implement stuff like that. There's way you can, you know, maneuver around to be successful through, because a lot of guys that are, you know, I went to high school with, not everybody made it to the pros. Or a lot of guys that went to college with me went to the pros, but some of them got education in the way. You know, their parents didn't have to play for education because of sports. So, you know, sports, arts, you know, there's a lot of things that comes together that can change, especially our society here in East Africa. Everything is being run by aid. If there's no aid from the bigger countries, then, you know, the center just gonna look normal. Especially, you know, in a third world country where we don't have a lot of facilities, we don't have a lot of equipment, so when people see the sports equipment, they wanna use it.
When he started playing basketball, Hasheem had his idols playing in the NBA and used to wear their jerseys.
At some point, you know, I used to literally, I had a Kobe jersey, number 8, but I had no idea, literally, this man will become who he became. The Paul Pierce jersey, you know, where he didn't have a Pierce, but he had number 34, a Celtics jersey.
With time and hard work, it got to be noticed around the continent and opportunities started to come. Then, all of a sudden, it took off.
I played very well when I was I was going to school here at Makongo Primary, and then I went from Gen Cisco. We went to a tournament in Mombasa. I played for the very well at that tournament. A team from Mombasa wanted to keep me. A team from Nairobi wanted to keep me. I come home. I tell my mom, like, man, you know, you're about to go live away from us. But you know, I was already living. You know, I went to boarding school here in Tanzania, so. It was kind of, you know, easy and kind of hard for them to let me go. So, you know, I went from Tanzania to played in Nairobi, played very well. And then boom, some words spread around, you know. I think, you know, I didn't know, well, Kenya basketball was ahead of us. You know, they play in a bigger tournament. So Tanzania basketball barely play in any tournament. So the word got out, you know, there's a Tanzania kid that playing very well. Before you know, people reaching out with I-20, we need to go, there's a school interested for you in America. And that's how it happened. Now, so first I was in California. I went to California, in LA, San Fernando. I go to Stone Ridge Academy.
After those calls, Hasheem finally made it to the US, but basketball was the tool, not the goal. He had different ambitions.
When I was leaving Tanzania, to me, it wasn't like, yeah, I'm going to play basketball at a very high level. I'm like, you know, I'm going to get education, I'm going to get a great job, I'm going to take care of my family. Literally after my dad passed, I told my mom that, you know, I'm going to go, I'm going to get a great job, I'm going to go to school, I'm going to work hard, we're going to be good. You know, whatever gonna happen is gonna happen. I'm open-minded to it. But basketball is what brings me there.
Although education was Hasheem's main priority, he soon found himself immersed in a new and more stimulating basketball reality. More talent, more effort.
To be honest, I would watch whatever I see and hear, that would be really that. But it wasn't really like, oh, bro, I wanna play like him. I wanna be like him. You know, till I get to America, and then, you know, I start playing and, you know, and then they're like, oh, you play like him, you do like him. And I'm like, man, nah, I gotta challenge myself. I still have respect to a lot of great guys, you know, especially of African descent that went before me, you know, the Hakeem, the Dikembe, you know, and now we have a whole new generation of new young guys that are playing in the league, you know. So without, you know, their footsteps, my footsteps, you know, maybe we wouldn't have the future of basketball we have right now. As basketball in the hall, you know, even Giannis being of African descent, you know, that goes far. So, you know, we'll get there, you know. Okay.
During high school, Hasheem showed his skills, attracting the attention of big names within the NCAA market. Then, he started realizing basketball could have meant something more for him and his family. From that point on, his journey took him to the University of Connecticut first, which helped him getting ready for the big leap to the NBA draft.
I realized basketball would be something when I was on my way to college. When I was heading to college, that's when I was like, okay, maybe, you know, this will be something special that I want to do. By the time I was a junior year, my third year in college, you know, I had a good supporting team, including, you know, my head coach that, you know, told me it would be a wise decision to go at that time. And, you know, I went, you know, I got drafted number 2 pick. So, you know, I don't know if I could have been drafted even more higher than that with, you know. But, you know, it was a blessing to me being drafted. And, you know, it was a life-changing experience, you know. It was I was in the moment, so everything was great. You really, literally, you feel like you sleepwalking to something that you always, you know, I never always dream about it, but once I got to love basketball, I wanted to play in the league, so.
The 2009 NBA draft saw him selected at the second overall pick by the Memphis Grizzlies, team he would have played his rookie year with.
To me, literally, I was going through the moment. No idea what to expect. Everything was new, so really cherishing every moment. Every time I step out there, I give my all. So really, I have no regrets. I had a great time, the ups and downs and everything. So to me, it was a great experience. Learned a lot, and now I'm, you know, I try to come back home and teach a little bit of that I learned on that league. Everybody have different paths. It's possible. Just being a kid here in Tanzania, I'll go to an internet cafe, literally, and send emails to schools and like any college in Americas and Google, find basket, they have basketball, or email. Some of them responded, some didn't respond. But, you know, I had hope. Yeah, kids don't have nobody tell them, like, yo, I did it.
Although basketball in Tanzania did not develop as much as expected since Hasheem became a pro, he's confident about the future. Besides, regardless for the lack of a basketball framework in his home country, he knows that there's the right potential to build something great. And that is strictly related to the existence of living examples such as himself.
You know where basketball is right now? You will see another Hasheem Thabeet in Tanzania. Maybe in a few years, not right away, but because, you know, it's going to take some building up to do. I would have thought, you know, for the past 10, 11, 12 years I've been in the pros and college basketball, you would think the level of basketball would have grown, but, you know, it's really not. Now I have time to come back here more often compared to how I was. Maybe, you know, we can build up some momentum and create more players. There's really no basketball organization. Barely, you know, people like me or people who lives abroad comes home, then we want to do something. So it's really not sustainable. Basketball, for something to grow, it needs to be a good platform and, you know, sustainability on it. And if you don't have that, it's really hard to create players. So hopefully in the future, we can create a nice platform where come up with a few players, you know, of our own from Tanzania. Basketball in Tanzania is still very dragging. We have players here and there, but there's a lot of potential behind it. You know, in the future we get a chance of, because I see the young talents right now where some of them I'm trying to help. Yeah, definitely. Now, you know, when I was coming, there was no examples. We were just everybody trying. Now they actually have an example they believe in. So it's kind of different. Now they see, you know, they can actually do it being from here.